together and pray and ask God to bless our time. Father, we come into your presence this evening. And Father, we stand in desperate need of your Spirit to speak to our hearts. And so we ask that you might make the truth that you spoke to us through John many years ago come alive and inflame and inform and direct our hearts. We pray you do that for your glory and our good. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I want to show you a short clip from one of the most famous songs ever on Broadway. But before I do that, I want to just say a word. We're actually going to be trying to go through this throughout the week, and or this weekend. And so I want you to think about each word that's here. When we talk about theater, we're talking about not Broadway, not television. I constantly get that pushback. Well, theater, you know, that's all make-believe. Any of you remember the Second World War and the European theater and the Asian Pacific theater, you know, and the African Mediterranean theater? Were those soap operas where they pretended? Any of you ever been in a surgical theater? Are those pretend doctors dressed up in white gowns, or are they really taking out diseased tissue and repairing things? And so theater isn't just about make-believe. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about God creating a stage on which he is going to perform the most amazing love story that you can ever imagine. It's on this theater, you know, that he is going to show his love. Where does that come out most clearly? At the cross. So we talk about cross theater. We're talking about all that God has been saying and doing that comes to its climax in the person of Christ and ultimately in his death, burial, and his resurrection. And then we put those words on the end, cross theater, that is on this earth, this stage. If you go to Broadway, you're going to see that every stage is not the same. The Lion King is going to be different than Les Mis. That's going to be different than the Phantom of the Opera. Every stage is designed for the play that's going to be put on there. And the same thing is true. In fact, Calvin said, this world is a theater of God's glory. You know, this is where he's going to show who he is. Now, I want to show you this clip, and I hope every one of you have one of these sheets, because you're not going to be able to follow the words of this song, or at least I can't. And so I like to see them written down, and I want you to pay attention to what's being said, and I want you to feel some of the poignancy of this. Sometimes we just fill our head with information. Sometimes we need to feel things. I remember hearing of a world-class ballerina that did this amazing number. And afterwards, there was a gentleman that asked if he could see her, and he was escorted back. And he said, I have one question. He said, can you tell me what that was really all about? And she said, if I could tell you, I wouldn't have had to dance that. There are some things you can't just put into words. And that's going to be true of the love of God. Now, I don't know how many of you have seen Les Mis. A number of years ago, we went to see it. And I confess, I slept through part of it. My wife kept ribbing me, you know, hitting me in the rib. But I went back and I saw this. This is a part where there is this gal named Fantine. And she's lost her job. She's going down the tube. She's trying to find a way to provide for her daughter. And it's called I Dreamed a Dream. It's about 5 minutes long, but I think it is worth us hearing that. And I want you to feel what she's feeling. Is that describing what you're like? Or do you have something altogether different? So let's take a couple of minutes and see this.
There time when men were kind, when their voices were soft, and their words inviting. There was a time when love was blind, and the world was a song, and the song was exciting. There was a time. Then it all went wrong. I dreamed a dream in time gone by, when hope was high and life worth living. I dreamed that love would never die. I dreamed that God would be forgiving. Then I was young and unafraid. And dreams were made used wasted. There was no ransom to be paid, no song unsung, no wine untasted. But the tigers come at night, with their voices soft as thunder, as they tear your hope apart, as they turn your dream to shame. With endless wonder, he took my childhood in his stride. But he was gone when autumn came, and still I dream he'll come to me. Would be so different from this hell I'm living, so different now from what it seemed. Oh, life has killed.
You notice those last words. Life has killed the dream I dreamed. Now, let me tell you, there are lots of people whose lives end up that way because they wished for a dream. And what I want to tell you is Cross Theater is not wishing for a dream. It's not hoping for a star. But it's an enduring hope It's altogether different. And for us, it gives a reason, a hope to live for. There's a huge difference. I saw this plaque that I dream for the things that I wish for, but I work for the things that I hope for. You remember the statement in Jeremiah where it says, I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a future and a hope. And I put on this list the statement from Romans, may the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind toward each other that Christ Jesus had, so that with one mind and one voice you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now listen to these words. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that He may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit of God. Now, that really is, here's what I'd like to accomplish this weekend while I'm here. To encourage you in a hope. And that's not just a wish. It's not a dream. It's not like this Fantine that everything was crashing around her. And if you build your life on some dream, some wish, if you build your life on something other than a solid hope, hope is not I wish. It's not like we hope for, you know, we're going to win the lottery, but it is this confidence that God is doing something, that He started in the beginning and He's taking us to the end. Every day that we move forward, we are moving closer to that hope. And every day, Satan and all of his hordes in this world is moving toward their demise. So I want you to see that what we're holding up before you, something to embrace, is not a wish dream. You know, it's not an empty dream that's going to fail you, but it's a hope that's going to sustain you. So you can have shattered dreams if you try to fit into another narrative, or you can have an enduring hope if you become part of Cross Theater. So let me take a moment and try to unpack what I mean by this. In 1 Corinthians chapter 4, the Apostle Paul says that God put us apostles on display at the end of the line as those who were to be condemned in the arena. And then he says this, we have become a theater to the world, to angels, and to men. Now, many of the versions have spectacle, but the actual Greek word is theatron. We have become a theater. The apostles were a theater in which God was going to show and share His love. And so as we talk about theater, we're not talking about make-believe. We're not talking about pretend. We're talking about finding the roles that God has called us to play in His drama, on His stage. And so we call that theater. But it's a theater that's about the cross. It's about Jesus Christ from beginning to end. And we've used the word God's love. Again, you could spend the next 2 years reading, studying, going through what is love. There are all kinds of different views of that, but we're not talking about some kind of romantic love. We're not talking about erotic love. We're not talking about brotherly love. We're talking about God's love. And I want to underscore that in a moment. What God is staging, what He's showing, what He's sharing is the breadth and the width and the depth and the glory of His love. You remember the statement in Ephesians where Paul prays for the Ephesians that they would be strengthened with might by His Spirit in the inner man, that what? Christ would dwell in their heart by faith, that being rooted and grounded in what? Love. That they would be able to comprehend with all the saints the width and breadth and height and depth. This is the thing that's going to consume our hearts forever. We are never going to get tired of God's love. And God didn't just say, I love you very much. He is going to show us that in a display that is absolutely awesome. And so when I use the word staging, I'm not talking about pretending. I mentioned to a couple of brothers who were talking earlier today, we sold our house a few years ago and we staged our house. Did we pretend that it was something that was not? No, what we did is we moved the clutter out and we took out our pictures and all the things you do so that it would be the most presentable and the most attractive as a buyer comes in to look at that. And so God has put us here. He's put you here on this particular stage in Lake Ariel in order that you might be those that are going to show and share His love. And the concern that I have, not just for you, but for the churches I've pastored, for the experience that I have, is I see so many Christians that check off, I believe this, I believe this, I believe God's eternal, I believe He's a Trinity, Father, Son, and Spirit, I believe, I believe, I believe, but then you look at the way they live, and the way they live doesn't match up. I'll give you one clear example. Have any of you ever heard the verse, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness? Don't worry about anything. Seek first, He'll take everything. Is anybody here never heard that verse? Then that means none of you here worry about anything, right? Because God said, you don't have to worry, I'm going to take care of you. Now, do you see, we know the verse. Probably most of you have memorized that verse, but it's not embodied in the way you live. You say the verse, and then you sit down and they're frustrated and worried and upset about the things that are going on. We want to try to bring those two things together. So it's not just a matter of checking off things that I affirm, a propositional truth that I agree with, but how does that get embodied in your life? And isn't that what 1 John is all about? Is 1 John 4 that we read, is this just about a statement of the greatness of God's love? Do you notice how it says, therefore, we ought to love one another? You know, if you hate your brother, you can't love God. How can you love God that you haven't seen when you don't love the brother that you have seen? And 1 John is not a dogmatic theological statement that are for the academics to kind of pull apart. It's there for us to see what cross theater is really all about. And so listen to me. Doctrine, teaching from the Word of God, is not information to make smart Christians. It's graced understanding to make faithful disciples. There was a man in Germany that convinced a whole bunch of people that the Aryan race was superior to every other race. Millions of Jews died as a result of that doctrine. See, we tend to think doctrine is just in church. You get doctrine in church. No, you don't. Get in the university, get it on TV, get it in politics. Doctrine simply is direction for how you live. They believed that the Aryan race was superior, and they brutally tortured, murdered children. I remember being at Yad Vashem, 1976, I went to Israel. And we went to Yad Vashem, that's the memorial to the Holocaust victims. And it's a moving thing. If you're ever, they have a similar one in New York City. It's not as big, it's a smaller version of that. But you know what I'll never be able to forget? There was a table about the size of all the chairs, and it was stacked up about 4 or 5 feet high with children's shoes. You know, little sneakers, little sandals. And you look at that and say, how many children went through that? How did that happen? It happened because they were indoctrinated. They believed something and did something about it. Now that's what we're concerned about. Indoctrination in terms of, what do we want our little 14-year-old girls to look like? The Disney characters that they, you know, I don't keep up with this. So the Hannah Montana types, I don't know who the next one is, but I remember that's what everyone wanted to look like. What happened to what the scripture said about being modest and not the braided hair and the plated gold and all the rest of the things? It's the inner person. And what happens, the world is trying to press us into another drama. The drama of this world, red in tooth and claw, survival of the fittest, the whole evolutionary scheme. That's not what this world is built on. It's not a matter of competition, but it's something altogether different. And I believe, friends, I believe that if you don't understand the storyline of the Bible, if you don't know what God's been doing, you're not going to know where to come in. Have you ever seen a movie or one of the crime dramas? And if you watch this, there'll be a scene or two at the beginning. It doesn't really make sense. Okay. And you go on, and you come to the very end, and what happens? Oh, that's what that was all about. That's when the package was handed over that, you see that. I don't know if any of you have ever seen Enemies of the State. But at the very beginning, there's a place where a guy just simply drops a thing into the shopping bag of some other guy, and his whole life changes forever. But you wouldn't know that if you just stopped it there. And the fact is, if you don't see the whole thing, if you come in 20 minutes late and go to the end, you can enjoy parts of it, but you don't get the whole thing because you missed one of the key parts over here. Or if you come over here and you see it, but you don't see the end, you're not going to get what that was all about. You got to see the whole thing. It's a whole. And we have to do that with what God is doing. So what we're going to do this weekend is we're going to cover the whole thing. From before, we're going to start at creation. We're going to go back before creation. And we're not going to stop at the end of time. We're going to go beyond that. And I really believe if you can get that picture and see what's happening, then you know what kind of role you're going to play at the point that God puts you on stage. Now, I'll pick on Ken here for a minute. Ken is going to star in Romeo and Juliet, okay? He's going to be Romeo. Now, what if Ken doesn't know all of the things that have happened and we just put him on stage? How well is he going to do with that? He's not going to know his lines. He's not going to know where it's going. He's got to know the whole story and able to fit in. And I believe that we're guilty of picking out a favorite psalm or a favorite statement of Paul or one of the gospel stories or one of the parables, and we live our life in some kind of inspiration, but we don't have the whole picture. We don't follow this thing. And so what I want to do, and you're going to see in the playbill, both on the inside of this and on the back cover, I want to just quickly walk you through this, and then we're going to look at the first two just briefly tonight. I want to walk you through this story of God showing and sharing his love. Actually, this drama, it's called a theodrama. God is doing something. And it all revolves around God's love. So go with me all the way back to Genesis 1:1, okay? We all back there? Genesis 1:1, in the beginning. Okay, we're not starting there. We're going before anything existed. Before anything existed, what was there? There was the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, right? And, if you think about it, and I've done this, ask people, if you had one word to describe God, what would it be? And I've gotten answers like creator, lawgiver, judge, providential ruler. They're all true statements. But you know what God was before he was any of those things? What was he? He was a father who eternally begat a son that he loved. See, love is not just about a world made with image bearers. There was love before that time. The Father and the Son loved each other. We know that from John's gospel. I want those who belong to me to be with me where I am, that they'll see the glory that I had with you before the creation of the world. And he talks about the love that the Father had from him before the beginning. And Trinitarian theology is built on the fact that that didn't happen. I was 22 or 23 when I became a father. God wasn't single for a while and became a father. He's always been a father. The Son has always been the Son. The love that they have for one another is so intense that the Holy Spirit emerges from that and becomes the embodiment of God's love. So that's how this all begins. So I've used the phrase, love commingled. Commingled. It's not lumped together. In fact, they used to talk about New York City as a melting pot. In fact, it's not a melting pot, it's a stew pot. There are chunks of the Portuguese over here, and the Russians over here, and the Haitians over here, and the Italians over here. And commingled has the idea that they're put together, but they're not mashed up the same. And so I want you to think about this, because this is the foundation. The Father, the Son, and the Spirit that share a common life. They share glory. They glorify. It's never like the Son is trying to draw attention away from the Spirit, or the Spirit is trying to divide the Father and the Son. None of that's ever been there. You've heard the word shalom, the word for peace. It means everything is connected perfectly together. That's the way this thing whole started. Do you see that? That's the way God is. And in this eternal fellowship, this dance of life, can I get a bottle of water or something? My throat is... starting to act up a little bit. the whole concept, the whole reality of a God that is characterized by this kind of love, you have to understand, thank you, you have to understand that that forms the foundation for everything that's going to happen. Now, that is the reality of the way reality is. Father, Son, and Spirit before anything existed, okay? Now, act one of this drama is, we're going to call that love expressed, where God expresses, thank you very much. This is the point that God is going to express his love. What he's going to do is, and we don't understand how this came about. How is it that the Father, Son, and Spirit determined that this love, this life, this glory that we share is too good just to keep to ourselves? So what we're going to do is we're going to create a theater where we're going to be able to project this, where we're going to be able to show it. And not just show it, we're going to be able to share it. You know, you read about some of the wealthy men in our country. Bill Gates has billions and billions of dollars. Jeff Bezos has billions and billions of dollars. Has he given that any of to you? Sure hasn't given any of that to me. It's one thing to display it, it's another thing to share it. And friends, this is the heart of the gospel. That God's not just trying to rescue you from hell. God wants you to share in this relationship, in this love, in this fellowship, in this communion that he has always enjoyed. So what he did is he created a world. He created a world in 7 days, 6 days, rested the seventh day, and we have a picture of how God looked at that and said, boy, that's good. That's good. That's really good. At the end, he said, it's very good. And what did he do at the very center of this? He created what? An image bearer. Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, let them rule over the beast of the earth, and so forth. And what he did, have you ever wondered, why didn't God create pets? You know, we have pets, we enjoy our, you know, pet skunk or our, you know, dog or our cat or our fish or something else. You notice God didn't create pets. What did he create? He created image bearers. Image bearers are made in his likeness. We have the capacity to relate to God person to person. You can't do that with your cat. You can't do that with your dog. You can't do that with your car. I had a couple of friends that had names for their cars. It was like their best friend. And you can name them that, but guess what? They're never going to respond to you. They don't have that capacity. So you know what God did? He made people, Adam and Eve. In fact, I was telling somebody, I just went on Facebook. When I grew up, you had two boxes you could fill out, man or woman, boy or girl, male or female. You know how many they have now on Facebook? There are 71 gender names that you can fill out. From gender fluid, I just saw Meghan Markle's baby, they're going to raise him being gender fluid. Well, that means the room isn't going to be painted blue or pink. I don't know what that means. You can be F2M or M2F. You can be polyquestrian. It's unbelievable. They had 50 of those. Just recently, they added 21 new ones. You know what one of the new ones was? Woman. I'm thinking, shouldn't they have started out there? You know, we have man, we have woman. But anyhow, what I want you to see is God created people as image bearers, made them distinct from everything else. Why? So they would be able to see the love that God is showing in this creation. The heavens declare the glory of God. The firmament shows his handiwork. Why did God do all of this? He did it in order that he might display his love in a glorious way. And he created man with a capacity to understand that, to be able to absorb that, to be able to feel that, to be able to enjoy that, to be able to participate in that. And so Adam and Eve walked with God in the cool of the garden. Now listen, friends, that's a very different beginning than the whole story of evolution. You know, out of some kind of chemical mix, an amino acid formed, and out of the amino acid, some protoplasm, and then there was a cell, and then there were monkeys, and then here we are. Now, that story, what's it based on? Competition, survival of the fittest. You've got to live, you got to kill somebody else off. Is that how this story begins? This is about survival of the fittest? No, it's about a magnificent, glorious Trinitarian God, Father, Son, and Spirit, that have a love that's so profound, they create a world and put on that people, image bearers like God, not the same as God. He's the creator, we're the creature, but we have the capacity now to see him, to know him, to feel his love, to understand what that means. You ever stop to think about that? Act one of this drama is love expressed. God expresses his love in creation and creating Adam and Eve to be able to know God, to be able to walk with God, to be able to serve God, to be able to honor God. Their whole life was built around that. And you think, wow, doesn't get any better than this. You know, here they are in a 5-star resort. You know, everything that they could imagine they wanted is supplied to them. And then what happens? This is still part of Act 1 now. Okay? Before anything exists, there's God's love, the Father, Son, and Spirit. Create this world in order to display it and to share it. And so the man and the woman that they put there enjoyed it until we come to Genesis 3. And you remember what happened? You cannot understand this whole theater, you know, this cross theater, if you don't understand the first 15 chapters of Genesis, Genesis 3 is at the center of this. The serpent slithers in. We don't know the backstory of Satan. You know, how is it that Satan fell? That's another story. We only have echoes at it, Scripture. You know, we have a couple of passages in Isaiah and Ezekiel that there's real question if that's referring to Satan and what's that all about. So we don't know a lot about that, but we know that God created the most powerful angel that turned against him and fell from him, and he comes into this creation, and his one goal is what? To bless Adam and Eve? To give them a better deal than they got from God? What was the purpose? It was driven by malice, to destroy everything that God had created, to tarnish it, to take that away. If you want to read something, it may be the greatest book ever written. It's called Paradise Lost by Milton. It's epic poetry. We don't read epic poetry. I started through it four or five times before I ever got through it. It is absolutely magnificent. You'll never read Genesis the same as you see the story behind this and how Satan, he doesn't go after the man. Who does he go after? He goes after the woman. And he begins the dialogue, and it goes from affirmation to twisting to drawing her to believe that God is not loving, that he said, you can't eat this. You remember, she saw with her eyes that it was good. She felt it in her mind and her heart. It was pleasing. It was going to make me wise. I'm going to be like God. And what'd she do? She took the fruit. I'll pick on Amy and Bill over here. So Amy takes the fruit. She doesn't just eat it. What does she do? She gives it to Bill. Says, come on, let's do it. Here it is. Here's our chance. Now, Bill doesn't have a backbone to stand up and say, wait a minute. My job is to protect this garden and run out these varmints. And instead, together, they choose this slithering serpent that comes in. And it's not that they broke a rule. Do you get this? It wasn't just that they broke a rule. They weren't supposed to eat it. What was it? It was infidelity. It was contempt for the love that God had shown to them. And then you remember the account? God comes into the garden. Adam and Eve are ashamed because they're naked. Now, they weren't ashamed of that before. And so God comes in, and something's different. Does he find them waiting for him? Where are they? They're hiding. And God said, Adam, where are you? Now, God didn't say that because he didn't know where Adam was. Okay, just the way parents do that. Johnny, where are you? You can see him exactly, but you play along with him. What did Adam say? Well, we weren't dressed for the occasion. You know, we weren't really. And he said, well, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree? Now, Bill, the man that he is, says, yes, I'm. What does he do? He says, it's the woman that you gave me. You know, it's the woman that you gave me. And God turns to the woman and says, well, it's the serpent and all of them. What are they doing? Instead of enjoying and experiencing God's love, they're shifting blame to one another. And what happens is this love that was there with the Father and Son that's now being displayed and shared in this world, that love is now going to be despised. So the word that we use in here is love is spurned. You read that statement in Scripture. In Genesis 3, you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. When you do, here's what's going to happen. Now, think about this for a moment. As we step back, we're watching this drama unfold on this theater, on the stage that God has created. And the man and the woman that God created to know him and love him now have shifted allegiance. They're spiritual adulterers. They've gone after another lover. They've gone in a new direction. So what's going to happen? Is God going to say, enough? I'm going to divorce this woman. That happens over and over in this life. And there are many people that say, oh man, if only Adam and Eve wouldn't have sinned, wouldn't life be so much better? No! No, and here's why. That was part of the script. Didn't just happen. It's not all of a sudden God says, oh no, they've ruined everything. What am I going to do? You know what? These things were already in the script. And what it does is it opens the door for God to display his love to a depth we could have never imagined. Not just his love now to the creatures he's made, but he's going to communicate his love to the people that have spurned him, you know, have held him in contempt and gone in a totally different direction. And what it does, it provides the backdrop now for the depth of God's love to show through. If you decide you're going to buy a diamond ring for your wife for your anniversary this year, and you go look at it in the case, are they going to take the diamond ring and lay it on top of that glass case? No. What are they going to put it on? A piece of black velvet. Why black velvet? Because of the contrast of that. You're going to be able to see the brightness of that. It's going to stand out against that. And friends, let me tell you this. I really believe Adam and Eve's sin was the black velvet that provides the backdrop for God to show mercy. Now, God could have shown grace, could have shown power, could have shown goodness. But guess what? You would never have seen mercy apart from suffering, apart from Adam and Eve being in misery now. And listen to me, the heart of the gospel is this, that God's love is not going to be canceled out by love that has been spurned. Do you see that? And the hope of the gospel is, and the very thing that undergirds everything that we believe, is that God's love is greater than man's rebellion and man's sin. And so Cross Theater is, how is God going to showcase his love? Do you see this? He's going to showcase his love by creating a world where his love is going to be displayed and it's going to be shared. Adam and Eve saw it and enjoyed it. They walked with God in the cool of the garden. They communed with God. They worshiped God. They served God. And in fact, the garden itself becomes a picture of the temple and ultimately the new heaven and the new earth that flows throughout Scripture. That's what God had for them. But instead of honoring God and loving God, they spurn his love. And you see, the hope of the gospel is grounded in the fact that that doesn't somehow antagonize God, where love is now going to be canceled, but it provides the backdrop for God to show his love in a way that you could never have imagined. And friends, that's what we have in this book. This is not a dry, stuffy book, you know, about sacrifices and cutting the liver and separating it from this part and that part. You know, I just went through the book of Leviticus. Most people don't love going through the book of Leviticus. But friends, let me, every part of this is telling us this story. And I am really absolutely convinced that if we can understand the story, we understand the plot line of this, it's going to enable us to know, how are we going to be able to do this? Because right now we're talking about how God is displaying his love. As we come down the road, we're going to talk about how he's going to do that through you. But it begins at this point. Have you ever stopped to think what it must have been like for God, for the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, to see the love that they've displayed and the love that they've shared totally trashed? You've heard the term of a scorned woman. You know, some man who's betrayed her trust and her love. It's very hard for me as a pastor who sat through counseling sessions where a husband, a wife, has to look their spouse in the face and say, "I cheated on you." I remember about 20 years ago, a gal came to me having trouble with her devotional time, and I gave her some hints. She came back a second time, she was getting depressed, came back a third time. She told me she was having an affair with a chiropractor. Well, duh, you know, no wonder your devotional time's not going good and you're getting depressed. And I said, "You gotta sit down and tell your husband." This was a guy, he was probably 6'5". He probably weighed 300 pounds. Big man, good man. And I remember sitting there, he did not have a clue. And he heard his wife, beautiful gal, maybe they were 30 years of age, saying, "I cheated on you." He cried and sobbed like a baby. I can still feel that. That's why it's not fun for me to watch a movie where they're cheating on one another. I've been in the homes where that marriage came that close to being ruptured. By God's grace, it was reclaimed. About 10 years ago, they came by to see me and said, "We just wanted you to know we're still together. God has healed all of that." And friends, think about that. Sin is not breaking a rule. It's cheating on the God who created you to know his love and to feel his love. It's not a simple thing. It's an awful thing when our hearts spurn the love of God. And that's what sin did to Adam and Eve. And that's what it did to Cain and Abel. That's what it does to every single one of us. We're going to stop at this point. In the next section, we're going to move forward. I was a little concerned. I actually didn't even ask Pastor Bill if I could show the thing from Les Mis, because it's a little bit on the edge, you know, in terms of what we're comfortable with. But, you know, I wanted you to feel that, to feel what it's like when all of your dreams come crashing down. Friends, let me tell you this. I don't know. I know a handful of you here. I don't know if you're living a dream that's going to come crashing down or if you've got a hope that's going to endure. But the message of God's Word, Cross Theater, is really where God shows his love, where he stages his love. And when I go to these passages in Genesis and I see that God didn't just make them crispy critters, you know, be done with them. I'm done with you. I'm totally amazed. I'm even more amazed. You know, I look pretty good to you. You know, I'm up here, got a decent shirt on, got a shave, and got my hair brushed back. But you don't know what's behind this heart. But guess what? I expect the same thing of you. If I saw what was in your heart, we would be ashamed to have our video put on this screen. And you realize God doesn't know just what you did. He knows what you thought. He knows how you planned it. He knows how you rigged things to bring that about. He sees all of that. And he doesn't immediately throw us into hell. That is an amazing thing. And friends, if you want to understand what life is all about, you need to understand about the kind of God who's going to show his love in the face of contempt, in the face of rebellion, in the face of having his love spurned. We've got to come back in the next section, and we're going to pick up right here. But I want us to just take a few moments this evening before we take a break. I don't have a watch up here. It's dangerous to put me up here. Where are we in time? What time is it? Okay, we got to quit right here. But I want to give you just a couple of moments to be still before God and ask God, not just so you know it, but can you feel this? Is this something that can get hold of your heart and you feel what it's like to cheat on God? I've said before, you know, imagine a guy one week, he makes two mistakes. He misses a car payment and he cheats on his wife. Which one of those things do you think he's going to address first? Well, I'm going to see the car dealer. He's not going to be mad at me. I may not live through telling my wife about that. You see, it's not breaking rule. That's what a contract is. When you don't pay your bill, you broke a contract. When you cheat on your wife, you broke a covenant. You wounded a person. And that's what's happening in Genesis chapter 1, 2, and 3. But it doesn't quench God's love. It sets this up so that God's love is going to shine through in a way that we'll never be able to understand. Let's pause, and let's just take a few minutes, a couple of minutes, to just be still before the Lord, and then I'll dismiss this in a word of prayer, and then we're going to take a little break. Okay, let's be still before the Lord. Let's pray. Father, we bow before you tonight, and we're so grateful that you created this stage, this theater, where you would show your love. Father, I still am overwhelmed every time I read this section and realize that this was not the point at which you wiped out the people you created, but instead, you go into the mode of showing the depth of your love beyond anything that we could ever imagine. Father, I pray tonight that you would enable us not just to nod in agreement with this, but Father, deep in our own spirit, we might feel the wonder of being a creature invited into this circle that the Father and the Son and the Spirit have always enjoyed. The circle of God's love.